to handle the kernel in your, for your device. Say you're working on a project and you have to handle a new device, and then you have to work on your kernel. So I will talk about different.
So I will talk about a collection of different issues or things you may not while trying to bring up your board, and then I will also talk about how to handle it in the future. So you have your device. The hardware has been chosen by your colleagues from the hardware department or from other people. So now you try to handle it. So the first way to get your device working is to use the kernel from a BSP. So you got your board software from your vendor, and then, well, maybe it's the easiest solution. The kernel has been tested by your vendor, supposed to be working fine. So, well, why not use it? The support for the SOC is fine, but unfortunately it has been tested on what the vendor made. So if the vendor tested only hard storage for on your SATA port and not the NAND, and you want to boot on your NAND flash device, maybe it's not supported. But at least the kernel is supposed to support every part of your SOC. So it's pretty much the most easier solution. Then you will get also a distribution. You not have only the kernel, but the kernel with, say, Ubuntu or something like that. The problem is that it may be some old distribution, because it takes time to bring up the distribution, and also it's the same for the kernel. Bringing the support for SOC takes time. We've seen in previous presentation, it's not something that can be done in a few days. So usually it's quite stable, but it's quite old. And on the plus side, well, it's matter of your needs. You have proprietary driver included, which are working. Because if you have only a .go file, of course it's for only one kernel. So if you want to try to use something else, you won't be able to do it. So if you're using the BSP, yeah, you have it. This actually can make some big difference, because some MIPS platform have some offload in order to get better performance on network, and without the proprietary driver, you won't have it. So, well, it may be a big difference. And then, of course, it's special for your SOC, so they can have some hacks in your kernel. They can use stuff that you won't find on mainline kernel, because mainline kernels wants really well-written code on no hacks. So for instance, still you have network drivers which are telling, yeah, my hardware is able to do this, but it's not to really do it. It's faking it in the driver, but it allows to get a lot of better performance. So yeah, this may be a big difference making why you would choose a BSP. So the other alternative is to use the kernel from kernel.org. So, yeah, well, it's vanilla stuff, nobody modified it. You get it, and no real supplies, it's fine. So, you have the support given by the kernel, and that's all. It's fine, because the newer kernel have a lot of support, a lot of bring up, and has been tested. So you may want to use it, but unfortunately, if you're using a quite recent SOC, you may not have the support in this one. So, well, it can be problematic. For instance, if you need support for the GPU part, say you want to only display some stuff on frame buffer and you don't have the frame buffer driver, well, it may be problematic stuff. But if you have a device without frame buffer, yeah, only a small device you put in some place of your app flat or, well, don't know, but you don't need the GPU, well, no problem. So you can go on this way. And of course, if you have a newer kernel, you get all the fun things like power management, cgroups, and so on. So yeah, you may want to get the newer kernel because of the functionality which has been added by the mainline kernel developers. So yeah, that may be some reason to get it. And well, unfortunately, on the bad note, you have SoC vendors who are trying to be good citizens, trying to merge code, but they're not necessarily used to merge code. So what happens from time to time is that they're testing their kernel in their reference board, and then when you try on different board, what happens is you may have build breakage or just things which are not working. For instance, if you have the MAC address of your Ethernet card stored on some flash and given by your bootloader, and then try to use your network card as module with the power management you have in the kernel, you may lose these settings. So it may be quite annoying to lose your MAC address of your system. So you have to handle this, and well, it's maybe some more difficulties. Also, it's a commit. You'll see in the by yourself what the commit is, but this commit shows that mainline kernel developer also human beings. They may make some mistakes. This one is just a small typo. They try to merge the support for the clocks for some device. And unfortunately, they had some mismerge, and during the conflict resolution, they managed to get the number of the clock wrong. So what happens is when you try to boot your kernel, it just freezes. And well, the machine frozen, no way to get your information. So it may make things harder to get running. So you have to take this into account, but you have still the funny part of the kernel, the newer functionalities, and so on. So you have to choose. Also, the other problem is that the kernel, the mainline kernel, has about 60, 70 days between two releases, which are about 2 months. I think that it's at the last figures given by the Linux Foundation. So it's quite quick. If you want to work on your device, it takes time to work on it. So if you're using the mainline kernel, maybe it won't match your schedule. So this may be also another troubles. And at the end, some years ago, Linus Torvalds said that people should not use the mainline kernel directly, because it's more for development. Distributors are making sure that the kernel is stable, is working. So Linus said that no, you should not use kernel doctor kernel, but the one coming from your distribution. So if you believe that Linus has a high technical background to say that, maybe it's a good idea to follow what it said. So what should we do? Should we try to use the kernel from your distribution? Yeah, well, if you're using a proprietary driver, EMGD, the driver for the Atom platform from Intel, which is based on PowerVR or GPU, well, it's working on some very precise XORG kernel version. So if you try to use a newer kernel, you have to take care that maybe your distribution is using a newer XORG version, which needs some newer part of the kernel. So you may just say, no, there's no way I can get it working on my distribution. So this will be a big trouble for you. But on the plus side, it's you gain what makes your distribution a distribution. So you get a lot of package. People have tested their package. It's it's nice, and you benefit from all the fixes and the support given in your distribution. For instance, if you want to some union file system to get a read-only part of your system and some small modification part, you won't find it in mainline. You have to use some patches, for instance, AU-FS or Onion-FS. They are not in the mainline kernel. So you have this kind of patches in your distribution kernel. So using it may be a good idea. But you, given the patches you find in the kernel, for instance, on some distribution, you may have more than 100 patches in their kernel. So if you want to integrate your work in this kernel, may take a lot of time, maybe a lot more time than what it takes with BSP or mainline kernel, because mainline kernel has no patches at all. So you have to deal with that. And of course, if you, depending on your distribution, if you want to use the stable version of your distribution, the kernel may be quite old. So if you have you need a newer kernel, you still have trouble. For instance, if you're using Squeezy and you need a kernel, say 3.0, well, it was not working. So it may add some extra work in order to get 6 working. So yeah, maybe a good idea, but you could have trouble. And of course, some distribution are adding some extra patches with new features, but they may be experimental ones. So they may have some side effects on your system. You may not want to have this kind of side effects when working. So maybe you have to debug this kind of stuff. Well, it will take more time than what you want. So given these 3 kind of problematics you have to make your decisions. And these decisions will impact you on your work when you try to patch your kernel and to add support for your device, but in the long-term support. So once it's done, you can't easily go backward, but there's no way to avoid making a decision about what to do. So what we've seen often is that on non-Intel platform is using the BSP. Well, as I said, you get support from your board vendor, so why would you try to use something else? And for Intel platform, given the platform are very similar, people are just using the kernel from user distribution and patching, add some small patches for the special board, and that's all. But of course, there's no rule. So if you're lucky, using some kernel, SoC, where vendors or other people did the hard work to bring mainline the support, you may want to use mainline directly. Say you're running a Kirkwood system with Kirkwood SoC, and it's well working on mainline. So, well, just use it, no problem. But there's no rule, but we've seen mostly these 2 things. But so now that you have chosen what you will do, you have to work on this kernel. So if you're using a kernel from your BSP, well, just add some small patches to support your board, and it's done. Okay, so you're happy. It was quick, and well, it's working. But unfortunately, in reality, you have to handle how to build your kernel. Sometimes you have to use softwares which are compiling and cross-compiling or whatever to bring you an image that you put on your device. And for instance, you have LTIB. You have LTIB, it's a set of script and RPM spec files in order to make an image made by Freescale mainly. And it's really something horrible. It's not really a RPM distribution, but it's not also only scripts. and it's really hard to use. So maybe this will make things harder to handle. So if you want to just change to the configuration, as I said, it's maybe hard. You may take a lot of time only to understand where to put your kernel configuration in order that their build system is taken into account. So, well, it will slow down. You want it only to add your board support. You've done, but it's still not working, and you're not doing some kernel development. So maybe you have to think about using something else. And also, the other problem is that if you choose some SOC and your hardware coworker said, oh no, we have to change from SOC because it's nearly end of line. So if you want to have a device running for several years, we have to change our SOC. And well, as I said, the BSP is for some SOC. So if you change your SOC, you may have to redo your work from scratch. For instance, if you're running a 2631 kernel on your current work and you update to a newer SOC, maybe you have to handle with 3.0. So it will, you have to redo a lot of your work. Oh, annoying. Of course, as I said, the build system may be quite complicated, so the only way to build a new kernel would be to rebuild the whole image. So yeah, you've done a small patch and you have to redo all the work. So not so really nice. And of course, sometimes you have bad documentation. For instance, I've seen some people as they wanted to add the support for their board and the BSP, and instead of patching or modifying correctly the system, they choose to create a script which will download and unpack the kernel source, copy the file they modified, and send build the kernel, which is quite horrible because it's not patchy, it's not being able to maintain stuff. For instance, if the kernel change, even the overwriting the files from the BSP kernel, they won't notice if the upstream or vendor has made some modifications. So sometimes using a BSP may be quite hard. And the worst thing you may have is if you're using a vendor kernel, you can have some abstraction layers in order to use by the vendor in order to use the same code on their bootloader on their kernel. But the problem is that if there's a bug in their driver, you have to understand how the abstraction layer is working and where to patch. So sometimes, in order to just modify a value of registers, it may take several days because you have to understand how to modify the code. For instance, this kind of stuff happens for people from Marvel, to name them. But they're not the only ones. At least, be prepared to see scary things when using vendor kernels. So the other possibility is to use a kernel from kernel.org or distribution. So if you're using it, what do you get? Well, security fixes. So you have stable kernels and backported fixes for CVE and so on. So if you're using this kind of kernels, you have them. The work has already been done by users, so maybe a good solution. And of course, you're not tied to some vendor version of your kernel. So if you need for other reason using your newer kernel than the one given by your vendor, even you're using your own kernel, you don't have these troubles. You just use the kernel you want to use. So you are happy and it just works. But still, like when you're using a BSP, you have to understand how to package your kernel because you're using a distribution and you want to integrate your kernel nicely. So hopefully for main distribution, you have some tools to help you. For instance, you have MakeDebPKG or MakeRPMPKG, which will produce you some packages for your distribution. So you don't even have to care how to write a deb or a spec file. You just use the tools. The only problem you will have is to find the right kernel configuration. For instance, if you want to try to use systemd, you have to have some kernel configuration option like cwhoops. And if you don't know it and try to boot, it won't boot. So about 1 year ago, Linus said that maybe it would be a good idea to add to your kernel config files some option per distribution. So just selection, say I want the config Fedora or config Ubuntu or config whatever corresponding to your distribution, and it will select the needed features for your kernels. So it's a problem, but some people are aware of what to do. And of course, if you're using proprietary drivers, the distribution are using something called DKMS, which is made to handle these kind of things. So it will ease your life to handle the build of these kernels, because of course, the proprietary drivers are not included in mainline. So with a distribution, you have a lot of things to help your life, provided you know how to configure it and you know the small tools used to package. Then know that you've chosen your solution. What want you to do? Support? Yeah, of course. So what you do to, if you were using a BSP, what's your future? Well, there's none, nearly, because most vendors are providing you a BSP, so it's got your platform and will never update the corresponding BSP. So for instance, if you got a BSP with 2.6.31, you will have to deal with these kernels forever. So it may be really annoying in the future. For instance, if you try to use some newer tools which need some newer features, well, you can't. So if you have to go back to the first part, as I said at the beginning. So what should you use, a kernel from kernel.org or mainline? Because you've just noticed that BSP was not what you wanted to use, because you can't handle the maintenance for your device. And also, for the same kind of reason, if you want some functionalities or need some new drivers, for instance, you have USB ports, your user want to use a new DVB USB dongle or Wi-Fi USB device and try to use on your old kernel. Well, you will have to face with a lot of work, because the different parts of the kernel are moving a lot. So maybe you will have to say, no, I can't do it. But what will happen is that people will be unhappy and you will lose consumer in the end. So to get the support in this kind of case, it's not really easy. So what would happen if you choose the other solution? So kernel from kernel.org or distribution or your patches. So, well, just rebase your patches. You have patches, so you're happy. So rebase this. Of course, if you choose to modify directly the source and recompile, it will be harder. So yeah, you should really use tools like Git or Quilt or Gwilt, which are made in order to help you to handle your changes. And if you do that, it will be easier to handle the rebase and update of your patches. So yeah, this will be probably the easiest way. Of course, if you have a lot of modification, so about 50 patches or more, yeah, well, it will take time. But of course, the patches, you wrote them. So if you wrote them, you know them, of course. So if you know them, you can update them. If you have to handle a vendor kernel with patches from various sources and doing things you don't know, well, of course, it won't be easy. So using a mainline kernel or from your distribution? Well, sounds quite easy because the only things you have to update is your modification. And of course, even you have that you have chosen your own kernel, you're free to keep your current kernel. Okay, maybe not necessarily a good idea, but you can do it. So, for instance, if you're tied to some version of Xorg and interfaces and so on, but you can do it. Sometimes, of course, you can have some troubles. For instance, if you have a newer kernels need some newer tool chains, or the newer kernels have some new functionalities like comp exchange or things like that. Well, they will enable in their libraries and so on. And when you try to boot your old kernel, it won't work. So you can do it, but it's not necessarily a good idea to do. So now that we've seen the different troubles you may have, you have some hits, some tips that you can try to use to help your work. So, as I said, use patches. You really want to use patches to handle, and also it will make your life easier, because a well-made patch like this one, for instance, you have a documentation. You know what this patch is doing, and you have also the name of the people who made the change. So if you don't remember, even with a good explanation of what it's doing, you know who to ask in case of help. Of course, if you just say this driver does that on just one line, of course, you go back several days later, and or years or months, and you won't understand what's happening. So, yeah, if you want to handle things correctly, make patches and document them properly. Hopefully, you have tools like Checkpatch. You can find it in your kernel tree. And these tools will give you some hints about what may be wrong with your patch. Sometimes it will even catch some small errors, logical errors. You try to write a logical end, and instead you made a typo and you use a bitwise end. So of course it won't work like you want. With Checkpatch, it can detect this kind of small typo. So use it, it's nice. And if you do that fully, it will make your maintenance work over the time better. And of course, the other things to do when you have patches, you try to merge with upstream, you work with them. For instance, if you want to add some new functionalities like, say, wake lock or things like that, if you work with upstream, of course, they will give you some advice on how to solve your problem, or if your design is good or not, on how to improve things, which will make your life a lot easier. And in the end, they may help you to merge it. So it's a bonus for everyone. So yeah, work with upstream as soon as possible. And okay, if you want still to use your BSP kernel, you should find time in order to use the main kernel and also the BSP kernel, so that you can switch to your newer kernels without having to go back to square one, like I said before. So do the two support in parallel, but of course, it takes time, and you may not want to have the two things to do in parallel. So maybe a good way to do is to work first. So to submit your work upstream, so you have review and advice and so on from upstream, and send to backport. So it will prevent you to have to do two times the same things. For instance, work on street.9 and in parallel 2.6, 31 or 32 or whatever. So if you just have to backport, it's a matter of only backporting things. It's not the same way as doing two times the same work. And as I say, if you work with upstream, you patches will be merged. So in the, when you will update your kernels with newer version from your distribution or from maternal.org, the patch would have been merged. So you just have to delete your patches, and it's one less thing to carry. It's of course, the more patches you have, the more difficult it is to work with your kernel. So if your patches are merged and you update, less things to handle. So in the end, in the long term, it's better for your support of your device. And of course, if you show your code, you will make your users or developers happy, because they want sometimes just play with some new hardware they'll find on the available in every shop or Amazon or whatever. And if they know that they can get the code, modify it, play with it, and so on, they will just buy your hardware, so they will be happy. But of course, this should not be a way to make them work for you. For instance, some people hope that by making their source code available, people will review it and merge for them the code upstream, and hope that they will be able to use for free this kind of stuff. So yeah, it's nice, but it's not the way you should rather work, because the user don't have the hardware documentation for your device. So it's better that you do, because you know your hardware. And of course, there are also, if you give some hardware to make sure that some people will help you in maintaining your device, to create some community and so on, this won't in no way make sure that they will work with upstream. For instance, a lot of people just send to a lot of developers some devices, and few months, few years later, they are quite unhappy because they were expecting that people would have helped them to merge the code in mainline. And of course, this did not happen, because they used it, they were happy, and that's all. They did not even try to merge code upstream. So if you give some hardware, don't think that this will necessarily mean that the support will be merged by the people who got your device. And the other thing is, you have to learn to communicate with your upstream people. For instance, if you just send patches, you wrote without any documentation and so on, and that you just send about 100 of patches in one time, people won't just read it. They won't be happy, and maybe will get angry reply by these developers, because that's not the way you should work, and it's bad. So it will probably make you work harder, because people won't have a positive feeling about you. So you have to learn how to ask questions, how to work with upstream folks. Yeah, sometimes you know that Linux is saying things, and can be harsh with people, but it's not the only one. So if you're nice and say, I want to learn how to do it, and with the necessary stuff, it will be quite easy. And of course, the last thing to do is to put some pressure on your hardware vendor, on your SoC vendors, to merge the mainline the code. Because if they do it, it's a win for everyone. So you won't have to use the distribution from your BSP, and if you want to update, it will be already done by your vendor. So in the end, for the support, it's nice. So yeah, you should really put some pressure on your SoC vendor to merge their code. And of course, it will improve the quality of the kernel you're using. So it's really a win. I know it's not easy, but really, you should consider doing it. So, if everyone is not too hungry, any question? Okay, everyone sleeping.
Okay, this is not a question. You said the last thing to do is to ask your stock vendor to match that correct. It's the first thing to do, not the last one.
Well, no, I wanted to end with the most important one. Because, yeah, of course, if they merge the support before even starting the writing the kernel for the BSP, well, it's more, you won't have to choose between three things. You just have to use the kernel doctor kernel or distribution. You don't have to just think about it. It will be already done, and that's all.
I would even go further. Right now, we have support from very good devices in mainline, and I personally absolutely refuse to use any device which requires a BSP, because I know I will not have any security updates or whatever, yeah. And my device is deemed to die at customers, and I absolutely refuse to use any kernel with a BSP.
Yeah, of course, but it's not always easy to do if you want to. As I said, for instance, if you're using a device with a Cavium MIPS CPU, if you want to have good network performance, you have to use a proprietary vendor. So if you have to use a BSP and so on.
I prefer to spend time optimizing code to run on standard devices than running such devices, which I won't be able to use as I want.
Yeah, as long as you can choose your SoC,
yes.
And your platform, which is not always possible. For instance, if someone got some platform showed by their commercial, and so yeah,
yes.
Oh, it's nice. Yeah, I will buy it. And then you have to work. There's no technical choice made on it. You just have to deal with it.
Yes,
it's not
for
nice,
sure.
But that's the reality of things.
For sure.
Other question?
I've recently been in contact with a company that was using a serial driver, and the serial driver, I had to patch it, and I want to put it upstream, and they said, no, nobody cares about the driver, it will be soon forgotten. So how you prevent that from going? Can you put pressure on your SOC vendor to be able to do that or to maintain code on the term? Because I don't think it means that the kernel is that if the code is upstream, it will mean it does not mean it will not be removed.
Well, code can always be removed. For instance, some platform was removed by the kernel developers because there were no users and so on. It can always happen. But if there are people who are showing their interest and that it's used, and mainly you have developers working on it, testing the kernels, it won't be removed because developers on the code is what makes sure that the code does not be thwart. So as long as you have users and developers on this code showing interest, hopefully the code should stay. Of course, if the code be thwart too much and not everybody is able to update it because you don't have the documentation of the device and so on, it will be harder, but that's the reality of things. And of course, your SoC vendors, once switch a newer SoC. For instance, they're working on their Linux latest Cortex or Big Little Thing or whatever. And of course, the first SoC they made several years ago, they won't care at all about it unless you have some IP shared with the newer SoCs, but that's all. So you really need some people from the community to work on it, or the SoC vendor. Make sure that there are some resources from their internal developers to work on it. There's no real solution, only tips about to do it.
Okay. Thanks, Arnaud.